Welcome back to Let's Code. I'm Chris Biscardi, and today we are talking again about Floppy Corgi, the Flappy Bird clone that I'm building with Bevy and Russ. Now, you can see that I've updated a few of the graphics here. So we've still got the gates in the middle for keeping score. Those actually do keep score now, even though we're not displaying them yet. And then each of the pipes has been replaced with this little smiley hill face thing. All of the graphics, except for the Corgi, are from Kenny. So that includes the background and the little hill people. But I think that these are mostly going to be placeholders because I think we can draw the faces and the spheres, maybe with a shader, which would be kind of cool, and have them do some things, maybe animate them a little bit. We could do some higher resolution images in Photoshop and use those instead. And then I want to also parallax the background at some point. So the game is pretty much done at this point. We do have that last like 10% of polish, like the time doesn't speed up, and there's a couple of more minor bugs. Again, the ground that used to be there is still there, and the collision doesn't end the game yet, so you can see the ground right here. I would like to bring the image for the grass down to the ground level so that it looks like you're landing on that grass when you land on the ground. And other than that, I think I'm just going to parallax some of the trees in the background. So let's go over exactly what's going on here. You can see we've got a couple of assets here. We've got the background. We still have the Corgi sprite. And then we have this hill. This hill is like super small, which is why it looks pixelated. You can see that I started building out a lib.rs, which is where I've put the pipe spawn logic and all of the pipe components. That is the only thing that we've moved into the library so far, so we'll cover that in a second because there's a couple changes there. But other than that, let's see what we've got in main.rs. So of course, if we want a score that we're going to display later, we actually have to initialize that resource. That is a custom struct that just holds a U32, so the score is always going to be one. It'll be score plus one, whatever. We derive default on this struct, which if you have ever derived default on a struct that has a number before, you'll know that this number, when you initialize it with the default value, will be zero. So that's why we don't have to write any code here. It's just going to be score with a value of zero to start out. And that's initialized by Bevy for us with this init resource. I also do some logic to figure out how many pipes to spawn in the first place. That is a similar thing. We're initializing that resource. It is a struct that we define down here that also holds a U32. In that case, we use the from world implementation. So you have a couple of options when you initialize a struct in Bevy, or more accurately, initialize a resource. In our case, it happens to be a struct. You can implement default, which we did with the score value, or if you need to access something from the world, like the window resources, like the size, which we do to figure out how many pipes to spawn in the first place, you can use this from world trait. And this from world trait has a function from world. It gives you immutable access to the world, and you have to return the struct that you are constructing. So in this case, we do world got get resource. We get the windows. We unwrap that because it could fail. And then in our case, it's not going to fail ever. However, if we moved it, so the reason it will never fail is because it's after default plugins. If we move this to before default plugins like this, then if we run the game, we get a panic on that unwrap that we just looked at. So on the left-hand side here, we've got panic that called option unwrap on a none value on line 74. I'm going to reverse this while we're here. And then we'll go to line 74, and it's this unwrap. And then we get the primary window. So the default plugins creates the primary window. We take the window width. I'm placing these approximately every 400 pixels. So I divide it by 400 to figure out how many pipes there should be. And then I'm going to add one to it so that we fill the whole screen with pipes. We also do this right here, which instead of adding all of these systems to run all of the time, we've started running them after we get to the next my states. These are horrible names. So after we load all of our assets, right, then we transition from my states loading to my states next. And when we do that, we start running these systems. This will be useful later when we actually have like a main menu and you can restart the game and things like that. So you can be in like a game over state where some systems don't run, and then you can restart the game and those systems will pick back up and start running. The reason that I really love Bevy Asset Loader, by the way, is because you can just kind of be like, okay, here's some assets. I'm going to call them images, and then Bevy Asset Loader will just handle making them available and keeping them around and everything like that. So it's a wonderful library if you haven't used it before. We've used it in quite a few videos before, so there's that. One of the nice debugging things that I did that I really like to do with 2D games, actually, if I'm placing things on the screen, is changing the scale of the camera projection. So instead of having just a 2D bundle or camera 2D bundle that we spawn, we can set a mutable variable equal to the default value, and then we can modify the scale to be whatever we want. So in this case, if I modify it to 3 and I turn the, I guess we don't have to turn anything on, then you can easily see that we are quite zoomed out. But this is all functioning the same exact way. So one of the really interesting things about scaling the camera is it doesn't change things like the window width. So we get the same number of pipes, or these aren't really pipes, I guess they're hills, but we get the same number of pipes because the number that we're reading in for the windows is still being used here. We just haven't applied the zoomed out camera scale to that. So that's why we don't get a whole bunch of extra pipes going through here. But you can now see, because we're zoomed out, how the pipes actually work. And I did change them a little bit from the last video. So there's no more sensor on the left. It's just whenever they pass the pixels for the window, they despawn. And then we spawn a new one right at the edge of the window. So if we were zoomed in to a scale of 1, approximately here is where it ends, and approximately here is where it starts. So zooming out like that is a nice little way to debug things. And you can do that with like Bevy Inspector eGUI or whatever inside of the game as well, which is also nice, but I haven't set up the inspector yet. This sprite bundle here is the background image. We've set the anchor to the center, which I guess is the default, so we don't really need to do that. But I've set the custom size to 1920 by 1080. I'm probably going to change this to be the window size, or I didn't worry about this too much because I'm going to change it to be kind of a parallax background instead, or at least try to. So I didn't do too much here. I just kind of set it to a value and it showed on screen, and that was fine for me. We've also changed the way the pipes spawn in. So I've created a custom Bevy command, which is something that you can do if you did not know that. And you can execute custom commands by using commands.add and then passing in the struct that you've implemented command for. So in this case, we get the number of pipes that we were supposed to create. We loop over each of them with the index. So we go from 0 to like 4 or 8 or however big the window is. And then we set the X value to a little in front of the corgi. So like 200 pixels in front of the corgi, and then 400 for each index. So 200, 600, 1000, etc. And we set them up all for like an even Y value, because this Y value we actually don't end up using. And then before we get into the actual spawning logic, I changed the way the control of the corgi works. So now we query for the velocity and the external impulse. And to get that effect where the corgi can immediately stop when it's falling. So every time it falls a lot like this, we want it to go up immediately. I don't know if the number that I'm clicking is good or not. And you can see that I actually have a bug here on when the window is this size. But we want that to stop immediately and start going back up. So instead of just doing the impulse, we set the velocity, the linear velocity, to 0 for both the X and the Y directions for the corgi. And then we let the impulse value of a positive Y take over. And Rapier will combine these two, and it'll basically zero out any velocity it had and then apply the impulse. I still think we need to increase the gravity a little bit more, because I think the gravity is a little bit more drastic in the original Flappy Bird game, but that's something we can do later. And then finally in the main.rs, the other thing that we've changed is in this, I guess we're calling it display events, which I should change the name of this. Anytime that we collide with one of the gates, we set the score plus equal 1. So the score increases every time we pass through one of the pipes. In this case, we're using an event reader. So Rapier and the Bevy Rapier 2D plugin gives us these collision events as an event reader. We can iterate over those. It's really important to know that when you iterate over these, you are having a side effect. You're setting each of these events to be read. So they are only being read once. That doesn't mean that they will never be read anywhere else in your code. You can, I believe, have multiple event readers in the same stage. But once that stage is over, and once we go to the next execution of this system, those events that you already processed will not be there. So we grab the corgi, which is an entity, and we use this marker component with the corgi. We match on each of the collision events. The collision events give us a started or a stopped. In this case, we aren't concerned with anything being stopped. We are only concerned with when the collision starts with the gate, because that's when you get a point. So I use the letters A and B here just because, I don't know, I haven't come up with anything better yet. If you have a better idea for what I call these two variables, leave it in the comments, because A and B kind of aren't great names. there are some flags here as well. We don't use them. And then one of the confusing things, or one of the finicky things, is that either A or B could be the corgi, and either A or B could be the sensor. So we have to do this like if statement here, or if expression. If the corgi is equal to the entity ID, so these are both entity IDs. If they're equal, then A, and we return some AB. If the corgi and B are equal, then we return some BA. So the order is flipping here. And if neither of those are true, we return none. And that lets this if let match on both the corgi and giving us whichever one is the other one. So we don't actually care whether it is A or B. We only care that we match on the corgi and then we match on the other. So if we can get the gate that is the sensor that is other from the gates query, which queries for entities with points gate, then we increase the score because you deserve a point. And then that leaves us with the spawn pipe logic, which hasn't changed too much, but has changed a little bit. Mostly we have this lib now. So we have pub mob pipes and then a pipes.rs that has a couple of public exports. Especially these are the components that we use in the systems. So I haven't really organized everything yet. I just wanted to move this one thing out of the main file because I felt like it was nice and isolated. But if we look at the top of the main.rs, we get flappy corgi pipes and then pipe or points gate and then spawn pipe, which are the three things that we want to use in the main.rs file. Spawn pipe is the command, our custom command, and pipe and points gate are both components that we use in queries. So if we go through the lib.rs, we get to pipes, pipes.rs. And I've added in the noise value here to pipe, so we pass that in, but I haven't used it anywhere yet. May or may not use that in the future. We've got, of course, our components that we just talked about. Get out of whatever menu I just clicked into in VS Code. I need to get rid of this little light bulb thing. I never used that. So first of all, to implement a custom command in Bevy, you need to implement command for some struct. In our case, the struct is going to be called spawn pipe. We're going to accept a transform to figure out where we should be spawning the pipe. And we're going to accept an image. So in this case, it's the smiling hill right here. So we pass in that image handle. And then we need to implement the write function, which gives us mutable access to the world, which is very similar to the from world trait from before that we learned about earlier in the video. I've chosen to access the time since startup. So that gives us time. I get it as seconds as an F64. There's a couple of utility functions here. So we can get like as seconds F32 or something like that. They're kind of nice. We get the primary window again in the same way that we have been getting the primary window. And then the big change here is that we produce a noise value. So basic multi is a, I believe, 6-octave combination of Perlin noise. So what that means is it's 6 frequencies, basically, of Perlin noise combined together to make a noisy, effectively a noisy sine wave kind of thing. Now, that can be either 2 dimensions or 3 dimensions given this implementation from noise.rs. So we do a get with this array, and the array takes the position at which we are putting the new pipe, divided by 0.0234, which is completely arbitrary. I'm just choosing a different sort of set of the noise to use. So if we use smaller values, they will be closer together and they'll be more gradual. If we use larger values, they will be much more spiky. So that's kind of one variable that we could use to increase the difficulty of the game as it goes on. For now, this is basically just a static value though. So I might change that. And then we use time to sort of modulate that a little bit. You can basically think of this as adding these two numbers together and then using that to get a noise value at some index, which becomes the center of opening. The center of opening is the point at which the gap is centered on. So when the pipes are spawned in, they have to be centered on something, and the gap is some height, right? In this case, the gap size is 200. So the gap size, or the gap, needs to be somewhere from 0 to the window height. This center of opening, which is a noise value, gives us a number from 0 to 1. So we can translate that number from 0 to 1 to 0 to the window height In this case, I'm translating it not from zero to the window height, but from zero to half of the window height, because we don't want the center of the gap to be like at the bottom of the window or at the top of the window. Those would be kind of odd places for the pipes to open, and they might not give enough room for the player. So let me get position, which is some value from zero to half of the window height that we use to place all of the other pipe pieces and the gaps. Now, the only other interesting change here from the previous video is going to be the introduction of a capsule collider instead of a cuboid. In this case, I've chosen to use the very verbose capsule collider specification. If we enable the debug plugin for Rapier and we run this, then we can see where all of the colliders are. In this case, the colliders match exactly with the capsule shape that each of these hills takes. You can see that there is still this gate here in the middle for each of them. Our corgi is a little bit oversized. I think we need to make that square a little smaller still. And then there's obviously the ground here down there too. So if we go all the way down, we hit the ground, we can come back up, and that would end the game. But I'm bad at this game. So I've chosen to delay the implementation of failing the game until the last possible moment. So that's the game. And then we flip the sprite using flip Y. So somewhere in here, right here, in fact, for the top pipe, we take the sprite. So we are applying the image that we're passing in, which is this hill image. We flip that sprite vertically. So it's from the top to the bottom instead of the bottom to the top. And that's it. We effectively have a noise-driven set of gaps that our corgi can then go through. And I still think that there's work to be done around the sizing of these gaps, the sizing of the corgi collider. And actually, in fact, if you make this significantly different, that's not the bug, because if I move the window, then it redefines where these should spawn. But you can see the collider for the sprite, or the collider and the sprite, so this capsule top here, not matching up exactly. So that's one of the reasons that I think that we're going to move from the sprite-based approach that we have here to maybe something that is a little bit more hand-drawn, a little bit more like a 2D mesh that we create or something like that, maybe. And that's it. That's the game. I'm going to polish this up a little bit more. I'm going to change a few things. I probably won't make another video on this for a while. So if you have any questions, leave them in the comments. I'm happy to answer them. I think that there's a number of things I'm going to do to this, but it's mostly like polish work at this point. The code is all on GitHub. So if you're interested in the implementation or following along with the future development of this project, go check it out on GitHub. It'll be in the description, and I will catch you in the next video. Have a great day.